Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Sean Hudgenwardle, and I'll be your moderator for this morning's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity, to this present day. This school was established as the result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are lords many and gods many. But we now know that each lord must have a name and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, nor Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of the Father and his Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edge of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This tabernacle consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today we will have a prayer by Dr. Don Thomas. And that will be followed by a selection of music. Our scripture lesson will be Romans, the 8th chapter, and that will be read by Dr. Aaron Alanis.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
Let us bow our hearts and our minds for a moment of prayer. Dear Yahweh, we just want to thank you again for bringing us back together here in class. Yahweh, we appreciate that you just keep us clothed in our right mind. And we just thank you for all that you're doing for us. And let us get whatever message you want us to receive today through the lecture. In Yahshua's name we pray, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And my Elohim is the only El for me. Ooh. No, I won't turn away. I won't follow the prince of this world. I won't cheat myself of everlasting life. For the love Yah gives to me is my liberty, and my Elohim is the only El for me. When I feel that I just can't go on, and every ounce of strength is gone, I remember that He's always there to comfort me. And when I feel this life is just too tough, and the burdens won't let me lift my feet, I remember that His love is enough. Is just enough for me. No, I won't fall away. I won't stand in the middle.
Yeah, good morning. Today, I will be reading Romans, the 8th chapter, and I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible, containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts. Revised by the late A.B. Trainup and the Scripture Research Association. Romans, the 8th chapter. There is therefore no condemnation to them which are in Yahshua the Messiah, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Yahshua the Messiah hath made me free from the law of sin and death. But what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, Yahweh sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, because of sin, to condemn sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is at enmity against Yahweh. For it is not subject to the law of Yahweh. Neither indeed can it be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please Yahweh. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of Yahweh dwell in you. Now if any man have not the Spirit of the Messiah, he is none of his. And if the Messiah be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is alive because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Yahshua from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Yahshua from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh, so live to live after the flesh. For if ye live after the desires of the flesh, ye shall die. But if ye through the Spirit do mortify the desires of the flesh, ye shall live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of Yahweh, they are the sons of Yahweh. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the Spirit of the adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, our Father, Abba, my Father. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of Yahweh. And if children, then heirs, heirs of Yahweh, the joint heirs with the Messiah. If we suffer with him, we may be glorified together also. For I reckon that the suffering of the present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectations of the creation waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of Yahweh. For the creation was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope. Because the creation itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of Yahweh. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit. Even we ourselves groaneth within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he hope for? But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groaning which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the sons according to the will of Yahweh. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love Yahweh, to them who are the called according to his purpose, for whom he did not foreknow, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestine to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestine, them he also called. And whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified. What shall we then say to these things? If Yahweh be for us, who can be against us? he that spread not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of Yahweh's elect? It is Yahweh that justifieth. He that condemneth, it is the Messiah that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of Yahweh, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of the Messiah? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake are we killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of Yahweh, which is in Yahshua the Messiah, our Savior. I have read Romans, the 8th chapter. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Thomas, and thank you, Dr. Alanese. Today is Sunday, and we have a lecture format today. For our first speaker, I would like to call on Dr. Eunice Reiser.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
It is an honor and a privilege to be here. And as the prayer was saying, thanking Yahweh always that he has allowed us to have that frame of mind to even know where we need to be at all times, especially here, to understand more about his purpose, pattern, and plan. I really don't have anything on my mind. There's a lot of things that's been happening, you know, in a few weeks that I've hadn't had the opportunity to go through process of, you know, funerals, setting the process of what you got to do and all this kind of stuff. And it is a job. And then also, you know, trying to help take care of family members that don't really have this teaching. And that's one thing I can appreciate, and I am now living, is what Yahweh has given unto me to understand has made this event or the passing of a family member pretty much it's accepted. You know, there's nothing that I could actually do about it. And we knew it in some respects. So bottom line, it was Yahweh's will. It is his will. And that's hard, you know. And because of feelings and physical attachments, that can make it even harder. But I've got an opportunity a little bit to listen to other classes. And I've had to go back on some things with myself to realize that it is important to go through the names. And I'm finding with people that I have spoken with about the teaching, it is very important to how many times we talk about Moses and this pattern. It is very important to continue to listen to it, because it is a lot of principles are being shown and we're not picking them up right off the bat every time. I mean, I've been sitting in here for years, and this is a fact that if you haven't been given the ears to hear at whatever particular time, you will not hear it. And I have had in this last day come to face that fact, is that as much as my heart desire, and I say that it is, that all should understand or want to understand, but if it hasn't been already set, or I don't even know the time set, that Yahweh will allow anybody to hear. I sit there with my daughter and we go over, you know, I tell her that Yahweh, Elohim and Yahshua, she doesn't really know that much about the church, but she's heard about the Trinity. Then I have another friend that doesn't realize, even though we say Yahweh Elohim, it is accepted, but they still look at it as being a Trinity and do not, it's not understood that Yahweh is his name. Over in Exodus, where Moses received the name of Yahweh, and I think that, what is that, Exodus 3? Mm-hmm. Where Moses saw the burning bush. We can go to the preface. But Yahweh did give his name. And it's not Lord. It is not God. And as we know, a Lord can be landlord. And you don't start off a person's, it is not a name. So that is just a description, really, like a father. But the name is Yahweh, as your name is Sean or Don. It's not the Don or the Sean. And those are basically titles. So in Exodus, Moses was given the name. And the name is very important, because all down here with the children of Israel, they had all kinds of gods. So he gave Moses his name, told Moses that he wanted him to go down and deliver the children. But Moses asked a very good question, which took me years to even go, oh, yeah, that is really a sound question. Like when I go down there and tell them that you sent me, like, what is your name? Because they had all kinds of gods down here, sun god, water god, sky god. You know, the locusts, you know, all kinds of gods that they worship. So really, what is his name? And that's the thing that I wasn't really in tune to. It is very important to know the name. And the name, when you talk to each one of us, we're introducing ourselves. First thing that we want to do is, what is your name? And the deception is all down in with the mass of gods and idols, because also Jesus Christ and all, it's in the same misconception, because it's not a name. Because his name really was developed from other gods. So, but the world is really entrenched in believing that, well, God know who I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. And that is so weak. That's how much importance that you have put into knowing your Creator, your Heavenly Father. And what we've been taught here is to start off with the names. Yahweh, pure spirit. We do not understand pure spirit. And since we were Yahweh knowing it, then he took on a shape and form. And also it was like what came, I noticed this morning listening, which I really didn't think about it, was when Moses saw this vision. Give me Exodus 3:13.
And Moses said unto Elohim, Behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, The Elohim of your fathers has sent me unto you. And they shall say to me, What is his name?
Excuse me, dear. Go up further than that, where at the burning bush. Because when Moses was looking at the burning bush, we know he was having a vision. And the way that we can understand Yahweh is through a divine vision and revelation. Because we don't know anything about Yahweh. So when he said that Moses turned aside to see a vision, he was looking at Elohim. Because Elohim, in a shape and form, you see the burning bush, which represents really it's Yahweh. Yahweh is the consuming fire. It was that fire. And Moses was looking at, he had a vision. I don't know why did I say that. It just popped back in my mind. But Elohim is the word or son. This is how we can understand these. We've been taught these attributes. This Yahweh is the source of these attributes. And he took on, these attributes took on a shape and form of a man. This is far from what I have understood ever before, and it makes so much sense to see that these attributes is what created this whole creation. This is what is in existence now. It takes our concepts and our opinions off of a God out there or an imagination of what God is. Because if we can understand and see that these attributes are already working in our lives now, this is what causes us to exist and be able to identify. This is all that is really in operation. That is what's have really been on my mind, is how truly I am not controlling nothing. I am not learning anything. I'm understanding that the spirit, the soul, is what is showing forth these attributes. And Yahweh has allowed us being in the physical with knowing something about his purpose, pattern, and plan, knowing that he was the one that caused all things to come down into a threefold pattern that with unerring accuracy, and that it is the truth. And what I am going to do, I'm going to relinquish the floor. Not that I'm really in pain, but I also know that Yahweh is working with me, is showing me how to bring someone up properly that do not know this teaching. And I've had my day to bow down to the truth. And I am still, you know, bowing down to the truth. And that's, I really don't have anything else to say. So I thank you for the time and the acknowledgement, and may Yahweh always bless and keep us.
Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Reiser. For our next speaker, I would like to call on the president of the Ontario branch, Dr. Christopher Williams.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
Can you hear me?
No. We can hear you. You're getting sound.
Can you hear me out there in Toontown? All right. First and foremost, it's always a pleasure and honor to stand before the body of Yahshua Messiah. Secondly, I apologize for my lack of a jacket. Grabbed the wrong one this morning. Wearing the wrong gray. So, you know, we're free-flowing today.
We're all jacketless.
Well, my motivation is not the heat, it's the lack of matching. It's embarrassing out there. And in fact, I wore that suit, that jacket, maybe like a month ago and didn't realize. I was like, man, something's off. I couldn't put my finger on it until today. I sat down, like, oh gosh, this is embarrassing. This has been a very interesting last couple of weeks of class, wouldn't you say? a lot of controversy. I think something to consider, and I'm not going to belabor it and spend a whole lot of time on it. I'm going to make a few comments and I'll move on to my discourse, because Eunice brought up a few things that were very kind of have been on my heart and mind in a sense. And then I've been trying to do something for like the last 3 weeks, but every time I have an opportunity to do it, I'm either not called or something else has gotten in the way of talking about this said topic. But I just felt like it was necessary because of, I'd say in the last 6 weeks, we've been kind of circling the wagons around this one topic. And I just felt like it was necessary. So I'll get into it when I get to that part. But as far as the last few weeks, I want to say this. We are a school.
Right.
And we are not a church. We don't care about your opinions, your theories, your concepts. We're not interested in wordplay, and we're only interested in what thus saith Yahweh and this pattern.
That's right.
You can say anything you want. You can dress it up really nice. You can make it look real good. You can even make it rhyme. But if it doesn't align with the pattern and it's not concrete and perpetual, that it's not fact and it's not truth and it's not proof, especially if it's not according to the scriptures. And there's been a lot of things that's been said on the floor lately that sound really good, but don't go along with the pattern, or hasn't been proven beyond a shadow of a doubt with a few witnesses called the scriptures and can be put on this pattern. So when anyone gets on the floor and preaches something that appears to be great and is, you know, makes you want to get up and dance and all that stuff, it has to at least line up to those two things. Is it according to the pattern? And is there a scripture or two to support your claim? I didn't hear any of that. That's why I didn't jump up and down. That's why I didn't jump for joy. And I believe when someone did get up and prove, you know, according to the scriptures, it was thus. Now, the one meat of the problem, the item that was brought up last week, I want to say this. In our moderation, we talk about, it is said, Yahweh is pure spirit. And in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable.
That's right.
He's told to him source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. With that being said, I ask everyone in this room, can someone show me the line of demarcation from the new earth state from one spirit to the next? You got a look on your face, Don. Present kingdom age, spiritual kingdom on earth, spiritual assembly, body of Yahshua, the Holy Spirit through faith, Pentecost, spirit law, spiritual age. Does anyone disagree with me?
No.
All right. Kingdom age, it's the Sabbath, immortality, new earth state, kingdom and immortality, spiritual age. Can anyone show me in pure spirit where's the line of demarcation from one to the next? Spirit is eternal. Something that is happening in eternity has no time, no line of demarcation, or nor bearing on the individual. While Yahweh in a body named Dr. Henry Clifford McKinley did say in 1960 that the age had come to an end and we're in a new age, no one understood it. In fact, I don't think many people believed it. They just couldn't comprehend it. Because guess what? Just like when they had the Holy Spirit back here, they didn't know what they had. They didn't know what was going on here. They just thought it was a good feeling. It's not until sometime later somebody revealed to me, hey, man, we're in a new age. It took till Dr. Kennedy told us that we were in a spiritual age, to tell us that we were in a spiritual age. Because until then, we thought we were physical beings.
Yeah.
Do we not? So while we're arguing about this side versus that side, it is only for your edification. Do you understand? But when someone gets up here and proves a point and uses scriptures, I'm gonna flow with that. We good? Thank you. All right. I'm done with that. Eunice brought up a topic that I thought was truly profound. I don't think she even knew it. She talked about the name. And I'm reading, I forgot my books. It's like, I swear, everything happens for a reason. I forgot my books because I washed my car yesterday. In fact, my car was so dang clean, I walked up to him like, oh, that ain't my car. Stop walking away from it. It was funny. And I left my books in the house, and I told myself, I'm getting some out of my car this morning. I'm like, oh, don't forget your books. I drove off without my dang books. I'm so worried about getting breakfast that I forgot about books. Anyhow, it made me have to read the scripture lesson on my phone and only have the King James Version. And they have some New Age King James Version on the phone, which doesn't align with the regular King James Version. Because I know those scriptures, and they don't sound the same. They don't read the same. However, it kept where you were saying Yahweh in the book, it was putting God. And so instead of saying Elohim, that was making me think like, oh, okay, and they've gotten real loose with this, where they're not even giving credence to the right portion of the union of the Spirit. At least King James gets that right. This version on the app, it didn't. So it just kept using the word God. All right? So my question is, what is a God? Seems very stupid question, right?
No.
Like, everybody knows what God is. I can think of examples of gods. But let's read the definition of God, because there's a few. Because I'm going to identify, we're going to talk about this one definition that sticks out the most. Because I think we all suffer from this state of carnality. Or at least when I say all, I say society. I'm not talking about us specifically. But whenever you're ready. Anybody.
Okay. One, the supreme or ultimate reality, such as the being perfect in power, wisdom, goodness, who is worshipped, as in Judaism, Christianity, Islam, Hinduism, as creator or ruler of the universe.
That sounds similar to what we talk about here when we talk about Yahweh being pure spirit, correct? All right, we're good with that. Moving on.
You want two?
Yeah.
Or less commonly, God, a being or object that is worshipped as having more than natural attributes and powers.
So that would be like Thor or some Greek god or Zeus, something mythological, right? You know, something we'd see in the MCU, right? All right. Loki thinks he's a god. Like he's very emphatic about letting people know that he's a god, even though compared to gods, he's probably on the lower end. But, you know, next one.
A person or thing of supreme value.
Mm. Okay.
A powerful ruler.
Read. Is that it?
That's it.
Do you have Google?
Yeah.
Pull up Google. Go to translations and more definitions, because we read those. Read three.
An adored, admired, or influential person. A thing accorded the supreme importance appropriate to a god.
No. Go back to three. Read it again.
An adored, admired, or influential person.
All right. Does that sound relevant to today? One of the Ten Commandments is to put no other god before me, right?
Right.
But yet, I can think of many of my Christian friends that create their own gods every day, which is considered in their world a sin, right? Kim Kardashian is considered a god amongst her many followers because she's adored. Read the definition again. Let's just put it out there. It's adored. Whoops. Damn, I can't even write. Lauren, get up here and do this for me. Admired?
Or influential person.
All right. So, she is adored. She's definitely admired. And she is considered an influencer. Right. Barack Obama, he's adored, he's admired, mm-hmm. He's an influential person. We can throw out many different celebrities or people that we deem are adored, admired, and influential people. And we don't look at it this way, but it is, based by definition, right, a god to these folks. Do you find yourself doing this from time to time? Mm-hmm. I mean, it doesn't have to be limited to celebrity. Yep. I used to work at UPS, and our district manager at the time, our district manager was this 5'3" black man who, if you saw him, you'd be like, what's Benson doing around, walking around here, you know, running this thing, right? But if you listen to him speak, this man sounded like he was 7 feet tall. And people adored, admired him, and he was influential. To them, he was a god. And when they found out that he was less than perfect, some people were just destroyed. Like, nobody knew that this man's wife used to be his clerk when he was a manager. People later in life, when they found this out, were fired for fraternizing within the ranks. But here's this man being held to this standard of influential or godlike state. And people found out that he was no different than them. I remember the first day I saw that he smoked. I'm like, how are you talking about people's fit, health and wealth, and you smoking cigarettes and couldn't stop? I was like, oh, what a, let me destroy me. I was like, I can't listen to you anymore. You smoke. But because in my mind, I held him in like godlike state because I adored and admired this man. We do that to our parents. The point I'm making is everyone puts so much stock in this word God. That we don't even consider who that God is. Like, the fact that we can let a title govern us and don't even put a name to that. And people just follow it blindly, like it's no big deal. It's just one of those eye-opening things. But given today's, what Eunice brought up was about Moses at this burning bush, the Israelites and their sojourn, and how this is the backbone of the Bible. It's the story that got it all started, right? And because we're so progressive in our understanding about this gospel that we kind of overlook and we don't give it a lot of due. I can remember in the 90s, just gave me a hard time about the 90s earlier. What was it like in the 90s? It was fabulous. It's the greatest time of our lives. For anyone that's in this room that was, you know, coming up. I'm like, I don't remember a better time. Anyhow, you couldn't go to a class without hearing about Moses. I'm just going to be frank with you. I mean, Moses in class was like breathing. That's all we talked about. And at first, I was like, yeah, I love Moses. And if I'm like, my gosh, can we hear something else? It's like it's the same thing all the time. But there's so much into that. And I remember the first time that I'd heard it before, but I guess I was bored and wasn't paying attention. But the first time I found out who was actually in that bush was in 1996. Will had just showed up at our house, and we thought he was just passing through. We had no idea this dude's gonna live at our house for a year. I mean, he goes, "Hey guys, I'm here for class," and then he just never left. It was hilarious, and I was like, "Man, this is great. This guy's teaching me all kinds of things." It wasn't that he was just so esoteric; it's just he was talking about things that people just didn't get into, and that's why people liked this class so much, because we talked about topics that people just didn't get into. So, with that being said, Matthew 5:17, and then we'll just go from there.
Matthew 5:17.
Yes.
Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets.
This is the Messiah speaking, mind you. Read.
I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
Now, that word fulfill is huge. He says it again in Matthew 3:13? No, 17. Read.
Matthew 3:17?
Yeah.
Well,
15. No, 13. 15.
3:15.
Yeah.
And Yahshua answering and said unto him, permit it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness.
Now, to fulfill all righteousness, the righteousness at that time was this law. That was their righteousness. And when I hear that word righteousness being used today, I marvel at it. Because people actually think it means the way you carry yourself. And they don't realize that the standard of righteousness was governed by this law. That's where it came from. And today's righteousness is written in your heart and mind. It is something that is imbued in man today. And it's funny, people actually believe that they have to teach morality in an institution like this, as if it doesn't, as if it didn't resonate with you already. Right. I mean, as a kid, yeah. I knew that if I slapped my brother, one, there's going to be a huge consequence for that. Mm-hmm. I'm going to get slapped back twice as hard. Right. But secondly, if I made him cry, I did something wrong. Like, my mom didn't have to tell me, why'd you slap your brother? You know what you just did? No, I knew that I did. I hurt his feelings.
That's right.
I did something I had no business doing.
Mm-hmm.
When I told this girl that, you know, it's not the dress that makes you look fat. It's the fat that makes you look fat. No, it was me being a jerk. Mm-hmm. I never said that to a woman, by the way. I just got that from Al Bundy. I would never say that. I'm not dumb enough to answer that question, to be honest with you. How does this dress make me look? You know, nice little thumb. Get you out of trouble a lot of times. Unless you have the wrong woman. Like, I need words. I'm like, oh gosh, never mind. I'm good. My point is, I knew when I said what I said, I was hurting someone's feelings. So I don't require anyone to teach me not to do that. And I was having this discussion, I don't know who it was with, but if I swindle you out of money, trying to make a buck, you have the opportunity to say yay or nay, but if my intention was to get money from you, mm-hmm. so that I can pocket this money and do my thing with it, mm-hmm. whether you thought you were in a worthy investment or not,
right.
I could say, hey man, he's dumb enough to give me that money. It's on him. I was wrong as two left shoes. I knew what my intentions
were. That's right.
I didn't need anyone to tell me.
That's right.
Right? So we don't come here to learn about morality. And when I hear Christians talk about their morality, how moral fiber and all this stuff, it just makes me, it just tells me that they don't know what they don't know. Mm-hmm. They really do think it's about some pieces of paper in a book that tells them what they should do versus what they shouldn't do. Right. Not acknowledging that they adore and admire influential people all the time, violating that same righteousness.
Mm-hmm.
Funny, right? However, Yahweh has a way of impressing a man with the things that he does that he's not even conscious that he did, right? So we read earlier in Exodus, so let's get it. We were talking about this burning bush. Just get 3:1. About Jethro and his flock and the priest of Midian.
Now, Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the backside of the desert.
Read.
And came to the mountain of Elohim, even to Horeb. And the angel of Yahweh appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush.
Now, Moses, look how it tells the story. He says an angel of Yahweh appeared in a bush that burns with fire. Okay? Just appeared. Just one day in the desert. Read.
And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed.
Which is pretty astounding if you ask me. Now, obviously, when you know what's going on here, this is a vision that's happening with Moses. If it hadn't been so, not only would this bush be consumed, but all the bushes around him would be consumed. But we're not talking about any other bushes that are consumed with fire. It is just this one particular bush. Read.
And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush does not burn.
Now, he's looking at this thing. He's talking about, I got to turn aside to see. No, he's got his consciousness saying, oh, hey, this is important, dude. You need to pay attention. Read.
And when Yahweh saw that he turned aside to see,
mm-hmm.
Elohim called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said,
mm-hmm.
Moses, Moses.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, here am I.
Can you imagine if a bush starts calling you by your name? Me, I'm running. It's going to be honest with you. Read.
And he said, draw not nigh hither.
Read.
Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground.
Now, this was talked about last week. Now, according to the pattern, the wilderness is considered the holy place on the greater and more perfect tabernacle pattern. So that's why he said this is holy ground. Now, we call this the sole of our foot, but he was communing with the soul of the man. It's an analogy, so to speak, to what he was doing. He was communing with his soul or his spirit. That's how Yahweh contacts a man, in a vision or a dream. So while he's talking to Moses, he's letting him know exactly where he's at. You are in the holy place, because this ground is holy. Not because it was special. According to the pattern, this is where he was going to be at. He's going to spend a lot of time in this area. All right? Read.
Moreover, he said, I am the Elohim of thy father.
Right.
The Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob.
Read.
And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon Elohim.
Now, he hid his face not because he's saying something that was so wild. He's like, you're the Elohim of them cats? These are like, that's like the Mount Rushmore of Israel, right? Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, these are the patriarchs of the Israelites. To this day, you could say, hey, man, that Jacob, he was a down dude. And you'd be like, right on, right? So he's letting him know I ruled over them. They worship me. Right. Letting him know exactly who he is, how important he is. Read.
And Yahweh said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people, which are in Egypt.
Now, here, I as a kid, or even as an adult reading this, I just read over this. As we're reading it right now, it just seems like just some words. But these are some very significant words. This is Yahweh hiding in plain sight. Read.
And I have heard their cry.
Start over, please.
And Yahweh said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people, which are in Egypt.
Now, I thought he's seen them because as a kid, I was heard, Yahweh's omnipresent, or God is omnipresent. And when they told me what omnipresent was, I just thought, oh, well, he's sitting behind your shoulder and behind your shoulder, and that's how he sees it. But read.
And I have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters.
I just thought he had a really big ear. I'm not joking. This is how I thought, reading these scriptures. Read.
For I know their sorrows.
I just thought he was just really empathetic. Really. That's as simple as I thought. Read.
And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians.
I just ignored that part. I'm not joking with you. I literally ignored that for 20 years. For years, I ignored that. What do you mean, I'm come down? Okay. Read.
And to bring them up out of that land into a good land, and a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey.
So here is this angel talking, this angel of Yahweh talking to Moses saying, I've surely seen the affliction of my people, and I've heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters. And oh, by the way, I've come down to deliver them out of the hands of the Egyptians. What? Are you kidding? Yes. Let it play out. It's going to all make sense. Just let it play out. I said, I thought he was just being empathetic, but he was being very literal. He heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters. He was there. That's how he heard it.
Right.
He wasn't empathetic. He was getting his butt kicked too.
Right.
So when I say that this is the angel of Yahweh, it sounds like this is somebody that is not experiencing the situation. But lo and behold, this is actually Joshua, the son of Nun, astral projecting to Moses what's happening in Egypt. Joshua's down here getting his butt kicked, telling him, hey, man, I hear the cry by reason of taskmasters. He's getting beat up. That's why he could say that. He wasn't empathetic. He was literally getting his butt kicked. That's the point. So it wasn't that this was Yahweh, pure spirit talking. This was Joshua, the son of Nun, literally experiencing this thing, because he says, I am come down.
Right.
The angel said, I am come down.
Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't like he was just chilling in some astral plane. He was literally in the physical body getting his butt kicked by reason of their taskmasters. I'll get to it. Keep reading.
And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land mm-hmm. unto a good land
uh-huh.
and a large,
uh-huh.
unto a land flowing with milk and honey.
Now, this was according to a promise that was given to one of the patriarchs that he mentioned, Abraham. He said, Abraham, I'm going to make thy seed, singular, a blessed nation, so that all the families of the earth, you, me, and everybody else, will be blessed. He gave him a promised land to solidify that promise. So that promise was an allegory or a metaphor for the promise of how he's going to bless all nations of the earth. This was the blessing. To be saved. Eternal life. That is the blessing. Spiritually so. But to show that he was going to do exactly what he said he did, he's going to bring him to this land. Promised land. Physically so. Because he doesn't just do something physically without it having spiritual significance. All right? So, we got the Messiah coming down to deliver them out of the hands of Egypt. And we read in Matthew how Yahshua says, think not that I just come to destroy the law and the prophets. I'm not come to destroy, but to fulfill. We read it, but I didn't explain it. That word fulfill means to bring to an end. As of a promise, more importantly, to perform. Right? So if the Messiah is going to perform the law and the prophets, we have to at least show how he did that. Now, the best thing that Yahweh ever did was reveal himself to himself and then hide himself from himself, only to later reveal himself back to himself. Sounds confusing as all get out. I can see it in Don's eyes. But it is exactly what he did. Because we just read earlier about in Romans that if you be in the Messiah, he's going to glorify you through the justification of his work. Mm-hmm. If you truly believe the report. If you were paying attention to the scripture. But I don't want to digress. We want to continue on in the same vein. So where are we at? So we have Joshua, the son of Nun, down here. Let's get it. Where's identify him? Man, I don't have my book today. 33? No. Exodus. Exodus 33. You want the book? No, I can see from here. Yes. Next page. You need to wait. You keep asking questions. You got to pay attention.
33 and 32? Or 32? No, because it
doesn't go. No, I'm sorry. Numbers.
All right, well.
Yeah. Numbers 12 and 8.
With him I speak mouth to mouth, even apparently, and
Numbers 12 and 8.
Yeah, it is Numbers.
Oh. What scripture is that?
13.
13, sorry. I apologize, sir.
13 and 8?
Yeah.
Of the tribe of Ephraim, Oshea, the son of Nun.
Drop down, 16.
These are the names of the men which Moses sent to survey out the land.
Mm-hmm.
And Moses called Oshea, the son of Nun, Yahoshua.
So he called him Yahshua. So Yoshea, or Oshea, the son of Nun, or Joshua, the son of Nun, was really correctly rendered Yahshua, the son of Nun. All right, so we've identified who's actually Moses' minister. Now, Exodus 24 and 1.
Exodus 24 and 1.
Read.
And he said unto Moses, Come up unto Yahweh, thou, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel,
Read.
And worship ye afar off. And Moses alone shall come near Yahweh.
Read.
But they shall not come nigh.
Now he said Moses alone should come near Yahweh. So come up this mountain by yourself. You alone, Moses, should come up into this mountain. And he's going to say, hey, these guys can stay at the plateau of the mountain, but you are the only one that can come up. Read. Right.
Neither shall the people go up with him.
Read.
And Moses came and told all the people all of the words of Yahweh and all of the judgments. And all the people answered with one voice and said, all the words with Yahweh, which Yahweh hath said, we will do.
All right. Now jump to 9 and 10.
Then went up Moses, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel. And they saw the Elohim of Israel. And there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of a sapphire stone.
Read.
And, as it were, the body of heaven in its clearness.
So, 74 people saw God. Yay. Happy, happy, joy, joy. Read on.
And upon the nobles of the children of Israel he laid not his hand.
Read.
And also they saw Elohim and did eat and drink.
Read on.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, Come up to me into the mountain and be there.
Now, he said, Yahweh said unto Moses, come up into the mountain and be there. Now, where is Yahweh in all this? Like, literally, where is he at? No. No. You just got here. What are you doing? Read.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, come up to me into the mount and be there. And I will give thee tables of stone and a law and commandments which I have written.
Read.
That thou mayest teach them.
Read.
And Moses rose up and his minister Joshua.
All of a sudden now, he riding over his minister. He said Moses alone shall come up near Yahweh. And then here's Moses' minister who is nothing. His minister who?
Joshua.
Now, we just identified who Joshua was. For those who just got here in the peanut gallery, that was in Numbers 13 and 8. And then you jump down to 16, Yahushua, which is Joshua. Mm-hmm. So, whoops. Dang, I can't even spell today. Lauren, you got one job. Now, Yahushua or Joshua and his minister, so Moses and his minister Joshua are going up to the mountain.
Right.
Now, to someone who's not paying attention or don't know who this is, would think, oh, there's something wrong with this picture. But no, he said, come up alone near me. Well, he's just escorting them up the mountain because this is Yahweh himself. Or Joshua the Messiah, or Joshua the son of Nun. Yahweh said, I'm going to give thee a tables of stone. You alone should come up to near me. So he's talking to the person giving him instructions. Face to face as a man speaks to his friend.
Exactly.
Where is that at? That's in Exodus 33, right? Or 34. Which one is it?
Conclude with what you said as far as Joshua being Yahweh's salvation. When you look at Numbers here and we go to 13 and 16, it says these are the names, right? And it says Oshia the son of Nun, Yahushua, and it has a number asterisk in order to look down at the bottom of that page, and it says Joshua is Yahweh is the savior or salvation. And just so it's clear that there's no J, therefore it's Joshua that's right there.
You were looking for Exodus 33 and
11. 33
and 11. Read it. And Yahweh spoke unto Moses face to face as a man speaketh unto his friend.
Read.
And he turned again into the camp, but his servant Joshua the son of Nun, a young man, departed not out of the meeting tent.
So this tent, which is called the tent of the tabernacle, the meeting tent of the congregation was pitched back on the backside of the mountain. This is where Yahshua, the son of Nun, dwelt. So when this fiery cloud descends on this tabernacle, that is Moses' notification. Like, we get notifications in our phone. This was Moses' notification. When that cloud descends, Moses like, oh, gotta go. And then he just goes and does his thing. And he says, he walks into the tent, and he speaks to, and he sees him face to face as a man speaks to his friend. And when he departs out, Yahshua, his minister, did not depart, because that was none other than Yahshua himself. Mm-hmm. All right? Now, he said he needed to fulfill something. Well, to fulfill a contract or a covenant or a testament or whatever the case may be, because a testament and a covenant are synonymous, this was a contract between man, which we can read in Exodus, but we're not going to. So this contract that the Israelites entered into was initiated by Joshua, the son of Nun. We just read about how he went up to get the tables of stone. And he said, and they said, all that Yahweh said, will we do.
Right.
What do we say at a wedding after you get married?
I do.
Do you? And he goes, I do. Do you?
I do.
And then we married, right? Mm-hmm. Well, that's what happens here. This was a wedding.
Right.
When he came down, the second, after the third trip, it looked like a bride. Let's just read it. 34? No, it's not 34. When he comes down with the tables of stone.
Oh, 25.
No. It's in 34.
Okay.
34:29 or 28,
start there.
You got it?
Where his face shone?
Yeah, read it.
Go ahead, Eunice.
And he was there with Yahweh 40 days and 40 nights. He did neither eat bread nor drink water.
Read.
And he wrote upon the tables the words of the covenant, the Ten Commandments.
Mm-hmm.
And it came to pass when Moses came down from the Mount Sinai with the two tables of testimony in Moses' hand, when he came down from the mount, that Moses knew not that the skin of his face shone while they talked with him. And when Aaron and all the children of Israel saw Moses, behold, the skin of his face shone, and they were afraid to come nigh him.
Where it said that he came down adorned like a bride.
And Moses put the veil on his face?
Yeah.
That's right. That's 35.
Read.
And the children of Israel saw the face of Moses, that the skin of Moses' face shone. And Moses put the veil upon his face again.
No, that's not it.
That's not it.
Either. No, I mean, it is. I mean, it's describing what it is.
Yeah.
But I can't remember what scripture it is. Yeah. It might be in the fulfillment portion of the book, where it said it was a man adorned.
Yeah.
Like his. Yeah. I can't think of it where it is right now, but. When he came down the mount, he was carrying it doesn't have it displayed here. He came down carrying the tables of stone like a woman carries her bouquet, adorned with her veil over her face and brightly shining like a bride does when she's just finally, she's married. She's like, yay, I was married now, right? So that's what he looked like a bride adorned for her husband. That's what the phrase is.
Revelation.
All right. Revelation 21:2.
And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from Yahweh out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband.
So when he's talking, he's looking back, because remember, John is confirming Moses, and he's writing how New Jerusalem is coming out of heaven.
Mm-hmm.
Because the first time Moses saw this vision, he saw Adam in imperfection. He didn't see the transgression.
That's right.
But once he saw the transgression, now he knows both good and evil. And now he's got some understanding. Mm-hmm. New Jerusalem. Because New Jerusalem came down with this table is a stone. Because they were going to be a New Jerusalem.
Because
once they get over here, They were no longer just, you know, Canaan's land. Now it's becoming Jerusalem, right? And to them, it was as a bride adorned for her husband. All right? So that's what this was, a marriage. Now, we have a marriage between the Israelites that was instituted with Joshua, the son of Nun. So he's got to fulfill that marriage. Okay? So this contract was instituted with Joshua or Yahshua. It's got to be ended with Yahshua, the death of the testator, right? So you can't have a death of the testator. You can't have a end of a contract unless this one take off the flesh, because he's the same one that instituted it.
Right.
Now, we read how that was Yahshua, the son of Nun. Now, we're going to show how Yahshua, the Messiah, was the one that fulfilled it. Now, does everyone have this?
Yes.
No one needs this? All right. I swear we need a better marker. You know what? I like this one better. How much time we got?
30 minutes.
All right. Now, at what age did Joshua appear down here in Egypt?
30.
He was 30 years old. Now, at what age did the Messiah begin his ministry?
30.
At the age of 30. All right. All right. So, we have the institution of that contract at the age of 30. And then we have the Messiah starting his ministry at the age of 30. So we look like we got one witness to identify this one with this one, right? Now, how long? We just right there in was it in Numbers? Where, yes, go back to Numbers. Was it 14?
13.
No, is it 13? No, it's 14. It's 14. We just read it last week. Come on now, folks. I'm old, but I'm not that old. But tell them. Tell me about it. Hopefully I get there. We're a day for a year.
34. Numbers
14:34. Uh-oh. I ain't that old. Go ahead, read.
After the number of days in which ye surveyed the land, even 40 days, each day for a year, shall ye bear your iniquities, even 40 years, and ye shall know the withdrawal of my promise.
So they surveyed this land to go possess it, and that's what we read the numbers, those names, where it said Oshea the son of Nun. They were naming the people that were going to go do it. It was 12 tribes. It was 12 tribes, so one. So for the tribe of Ephraim, you had Oshea. So everyone from their tribe sent out a representation to go spy out the land. They were out there for 40 days, and they came back. 10 of them said, hey, they got giants. We ain't fighting them giants. You crazy? But Ephraim, Joshua and who was it?
Caleb.
And Caleb said, man, they got big fruit. We could do this. Fortified cities is great. We just got to take it. So they was like, nah, we're going to go. We don't want to fight no giants. Y'all was like, you didn't fight your last fight. I did.
You're right.
But he said, it's all good. I'm going to just put y'all out here for an old 40 years and let all y'all die off.
Right.
A lot can happen in 40 years, man. In 40 years. And, you know, I remember reading this. thinking to myself as a kid, like, man, how do you know that the last one died off? Like, just think about that. There's a million people, over a million people in this tribe. You gotta wait till a whole bunch of people die to move on to the next level. For 40 years, who's tallying these people? I kept thinking about that as a kid. I'm like, man, this is wild. Who is tracking this? Because that's how I think, right? We track everything we do. And yet, Joshua's sitting there right up. He's gone. She's gone. Yep, they're gone. I mean, he's like right there. So for 40 years, he's counting these people like, yep, done. Up, it's time. Let's go, guys. And they were out in the wilderness for 40 years. Matthew 4 and 1.
Then Joshua led up of the Spirit into the wilderness.
Uh-huh.
And then Joshua was led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the adversary.
Read.
And after he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry.
So we got a principle of 40 there, right? So they were in this wilderness of Sinai, wilderness, for 40 years. The Messiah was in the wilderness fasting for 40 days and 40 nights.
40 days for a year.
We're doing all right.
Day for a year.
Yeah. We're doing all right. Joshua 1. Anybody? Where are my skillionaires?
1 and 1?
Yeah.
Now after the death of Moses, the servant of Yahweh, it came to pass that Yahweh spake unto Joshua the son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore arise, go over this Jordan, and thou and all this people, unto the land which I do give to them, even to the children of Israel.
All right. Read.
Every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, that I have given unto you, as I said unto Moses, from the wilderness and this Lebanon, even unto the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, and unto the great sea towards the going down of the sun shall be your coast.
All right, so now they're getting ready to cross over the River Jordan to go fight and take this land. Get to 24. Not to 24, no, chapter 24, sorry.
24 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
And Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and called for the Israel, for the elders of Israel, and for their heads, and for their judges, and for their officers, and they presented themselves before Elohim.
Read.
And Joshua said unto all the people, thus saith Yahweh Elohim of Israel.
That's fine. That's fine. I don't want it. We're going to, it's going to, it might be in Samuel. I want to get how many years they were fighting. It might be Samuel 101.
Now there was a certain man of Ramoth.
No. Check the second chapter. You know what I'm looking for? I can't think of it where it talks about how many years they're up here fighting. But I'll give you the cheat sheet. They fought for 40 years. All right? So for 40 years, they fought to get that land. All right? Now, Acts, where it talks about him tarrying for 40 days. 4:18? Man, it's going to bother me until I figure that out. Oh, is this 1 Samuel 4:18? Read that.
And it came to pass when he made mention of the ark of Yahweh that he fell from off the seat backwards by the side of the gate, and his neck broke, and he died. For he was an old man, and that's not it. And he judged Israel 40 years.
No, that's not it. Did you find it in Acts? No. No, no one got it. Deuteronomy? No, it's not Deuteronomy. What Deuteronomy?
I'm sorry.
It's okay. Now I need Acts, where the Messiah tarried on the earth for 40 days.
Oh, 1 and 28, I think.
It's not 1 and 28. It only goes to.
Where's my? He was just when he went. It's 1.
No.
Joseph called Babylon.
It would be in the second chapter, if anything.
That's when he was saw him resurrect, right?
No. So they see him resurrect.
He was still on earth.
Pentecost at 2 and 14.
40.
One and three, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, yes, being seen of them 40 days,
that's it,
and speaking,
yeah,
that's it,
of the things pertaining to the kingdom of Yahweh.
So he teared on the earth for 40 days, correct? All right. So we got 40 years of fighting. We got 40 days tearing on the earth after the resurrection. All right, so we got 110. Now, it was brought out last week about 120, right?
Yeah.
Right.
All right. Now, just to make sure that these people are who they say they are, get me Genesis 50 and what, 49?
There's no 50-49. Joseph?
We're Joseph. I'm in the place of Elohim. No.
50-19, and Joseph, yeah, said unto them,
yeah,
fear not, for I am in the place of Elohim.
Read.
But as for you, ye thought evil against me.
Mm-hmm.
But Yahweh meant it unto good, to bring to pass, as it were, this day, to save much people alive.
Read.
Now therefore, fear ye not. I will nourish you and your little ones.
Mm-hmm.
And he comforted them,
mm-hmm,
and spake kindly unto them.
Read.
And Joseph dwelt in Egypt, he and his father's house.
Read.
And Joseph lived 110 years. And Joseph saw Ephraim's children of the third generation, the children also of Machir.
Now, he said Joseph saw Ephraim, correct?
Yes.
What tribe was Joshua the son of Nun representative of?
Ephraim's.
What is that, just coincidence? He says, I'm in the place of Elohim. Isn't that Elohim?
Yeah.
Isn't that Elohim? In the place of, right? Identifying, showing that 110 and how significant it is, right?
Mm-hmm.
But we're not done. So this one came from the same tribe as this one. Because remember, Joseph died before they got over on the other side of the Red Sea. So Ephraim was the representative of Joseph.
Mm-hmm.
It would have been the tribe of Joseph, but he died. So you had Ephraim. That's why he said, I live to see his kids. Read, right? So now we got witnesses identifying, showing that what this one was doing and what this one did, and we have a witness in between.
Mm-hmm.
All right? This one is attached to this one, 110, 110, 110. All right? Now, where's it at? We just read it about Moses when he died. Did it say what his age was?
No, that was Joshua
101. Is it Joshua
101?
Yeah, but does it talk about his age?
Joshua's age?
No, the Messiah, Moses when he passed.
Yeah.
It does. I think it's somewhere in there. It might be at the end. End of Joshua chapter 1, where it talks about Moses being 100.
120.
Well, I know how old he was. That we knew. I want to get it read so that no one just thinks I'm just making this stuff up. Remember, we got to prove all things.
Remember your mouth, remember your word.
The one day I forget my books. Dag nabbit. Deuteronomy 34 and 7?
Yeah.
Deuteronomy 34 and 7.
Mm-hmm.
And Moses was 120 years old when he died. His eye was not dim, nor his natural force abated.
All right. So, Moses took off the flesh, or was translated, or buried in Mount Nebo at 120 years old. Now, last week, it was talked about on the floor about how that 120 is significant. Now, this is the only place I know of where 120 is relevant. Now, we had a witness to Yahshua, the son of Nun, and Yahshua Messiah with Joseph at 110. Now, Moses is going to be a witness of the 120 with Joshua, the son of Nun, and with him here. Now, get me Joshua 24 at the end of the, when he says you talk off the flesh. 24, and I don't know what the last scripture is. You'll find it. It's at the end of the scripture.
Sure,
why not?
And it came to pass after these things that Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of Yahweh, died, being 110 years old.
Okay. Now, that's 110. Now, 10 years later was a Jubilee year. All right? Mm-hmm. And at 10 years later is when they celebrated their first Jubilee. And that's when you get to Joshua resurrecting. The next chapter?
Judges 1 and 1?
Correct.
Now after the death of Joshua, it came to pass that the children of Israel asked Yahweh, saying, who shall go up for us against the Canaanites first to fight against them?
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh said, Judah shall go up. Behold, I have delivered the land into his hand. And Judah said unto Simeon his brother, come up with me into my lot.
Second chapter.
Right.
And the angel of Yahweh came up from Gilgal to Bochim and said, I made you to go up out of Egypt.
It says, and the angel of Yahweh, right? Mm-hmm.
Right.
Now, wasn't this the angel of Yahweh back here?
Right.
We identified this angel of Yahweh was Joshua, the son of Nun, right? Or Yahshua, the son of Nun, correct? Now, go ahead and read.
I made you to go up out of Egypt And I have brought you into the land which I swear unto your fathers. And I said, I will never break my covenant with you. And ye shall make no league with the inhabitants of this land. Ye shall throw down their altars. But ye have not obeyed my voice. Why have ye done this? Wherefore I also said, I will not drive them out from before you, but they shall be as thorns in your sides, and their idols shall be a snare unto you.
Keep reading.
And it came to pass, when the angel of Yahweh spake these words unto all the children of Israel, that the people lifted up their voice and wept. And they called the name of that place Bochim, and they sacrificed there unto Yahweh. And when Joshua had let the people go, the children of Israel went every man into his inheritance to possess the land.
Now, first, it says the angel of Yahweh starts speaking, right? Mm-hmm. Now, this is after the, so we already read that Joshua died in the previous scripture.
Right.
In the previous chapter. Now, the angel of Yahweh came and spake to them. Because they were sitting there trying to figure out who's going to fight. Who are we going to send to fight? Because they're scared, because now they don't have Joshua leading them in the flesh. Right. So now they're wondering who's going to do the fighting for us now. So here the angel Yahweh starts speaking, says, didn't I do this for you? Didn't I do that for you? Didn't I do this for you? Telling them that I did all this. This is the angel talking. And then at the end of it, it says, and Joshua let the people go. So it went from being the angel of Yahweh to Joshua, letting you know that after he died, he resurrected and started speaking to the men and then let him go and then went back into his rest. So he had a death, burial, and a resurrection with Joshua, the son of Nun. Because remember, Matthew 5:17, think not I have come to destroy the law and the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. So this is a fulfillment, not an institution. This was instituted with Joshua, the son of Nun. He had to perform it. They baptized back here with water. He baptized with water. Took it out of the way. They did Passovers. He did Passovers. They did sacrifices. He did sacrifices. They followed the Ten Commandment law. He followed the Ten Commandment law. They did circumcisions. He was circumcised. They did ceremonies. He did ceremonies. Everything that was in this law, all 613 judgments, statutes, and ordinances, he did. He performed them.
Right.
He performed in this last one. This was 10 years after, which was on the Jubilee, when that occurred. I can't remember the scripture. I have to go back and get it. Bringing them to 120. Right? So now, you have Moses dying at the age of 120. So now we got to find 120 with the Messiah. It is in Acts, the second chapter. I don't remember where it's at, but you got to find it. Anybody? So in the first chapter, he teared on the earth for 40 days. And then he ascended up. No, you know, I take that back. Wherever the ascension is, what is that? Acts 1 and 9. Sorry, same chapter. Acts 1 and 9.
Acts 1 and 9.
Yeah.
And when he had spoken these things while they beheld, he was taken up and a cloud received him.
Oh, wait. Just start at the beginning. Start at 1. We got time. Well, at least we got a few minutes.
The Read. Former treaties have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Joshua began both to do and teach, until the day in which he was taken up. After that, he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandment unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of Yahweh.
Read.
And being assembled together, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which said he, ye have heard of me.
Mm-hmm.
For John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days hence.
Read.
When they therefore were come together, they asked him, saying, Rabbi, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom of Israel? And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the time or the seasons which the Father has put in his own power.
Read.
But ye shall receive power after the Holy Spirit is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth.
Read.
And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly towards heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven?
Read.
This same Yahshua, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come to like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven.
Read.
Then returned they unto Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is from Jerusalem a Sabbath day journey. And when they were come in, they went up unto the upper room, where abode both Peter and James and John and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, the son of Alphae,
mm-hmm.
and Simon, and the Zealot, and Judah, the brother of James.
Read.
These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women, and Miriam, the mother of Yahshua, and with his brethren.
Mm-hmm.
And in those days, Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples and said, the number of names together were about 120.
Read.
Men and brethren, this scripture must needs have been fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit by the mouth of David spake before concerning Judah, which was guide to them that took Yahshua.
Read.
For he was numbered with us and had obtained part of this ministry. Now this man purchased a field with the reward of iniquity.
No. Yeah. Did it say anything in the beginning about how many days were there? It said it was a Sabbath day's journey.
Right.
Yeah, that's 7 days. But I'm trying to think of where the other 3 days came from. But the point of the matter is, he turned 10 days after he ascended, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit occurred. Is this that's the first chapter, right?
Mm-hmm.
Go to the second chapter.
Start from the beginning.
When the day fully come. Scroll up. Poor favor. Scroll down. Yeah, keep going. Right. Stay. Stop.
7 years later.
Let's go. Keep going. Stop. Keep going. Keep going. Stop. No, I can't find it. It'll come back to me later. But he 10 days after he tarried. Yeah, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, which is 120 with the Messiah, 120 with Moses, 120 with Joshua, son of Nun. That's the 120 I know. Okay? So that's how you identify that the Messiah actually did what he said he did. So he proved, well, I just proved that the Messiah actually did fulfill the law and the prophets. Now, there were three trips with Moses. The first one's when he got, when they get the Ten Commandments, okay? That's when the Messiah, that's when Yahshua spoke, well, excuse me, Yahweh spoke the Ten Commandments down to the people. That was the first time Moses went up to the mountain. Second time was Exodus 24, 9, and 10. Yahshua and his ministry, Moses and his ministry, Yahshua rose up, and he got the Ten Commandments, the law, the Ten Commandments, which he broke when they saw that golden calf, right? And the third one, he had to bring his own tables of stone, and he saw the seven days of creation plus the genealogies and pedigrees. Yes.
It's Acts 2, 1 through 4.
Okay.
Because it explains when the day of Pentecost was fully come, while they were all in accord in one place. I'll just read it. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, that's the 10 days later, because Pentecost, while they were all with one accord in one place, there suddenly came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues as like a fire and rested upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit as it began to speak with other tongues and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. That's the outpouring. That's that 10. Right. Is that what you were looking for?
No, it wasn't. But I'll get it when I'm not even thinking about it.
All right.
So with the Messiah. The first one was this first trip. That first time on the mount was Sermon on the Mount, where he spoke the Beatitudes, where in old times he talked about the Ten Commandments throughout the Beatitudes. Right. The next time it was Mount Transfiguration, where he in front of Peter, James and John, you see Moses and John the Baptist. And there was a tabernacle that was mentioned in that scripture. I'm getting down. Don't worry about it. I got to go. So just like Moses saw the tabernacle pattern in the second trip, on the second time Yahshua the Messiah was in a Mount Transfiguration, you hear about the tabernacle pattern. Moses' third trip is when he brought down his own tables of stone, and he saw the transgression, and he was illuminated. We read it earlier. How about a bride adorned for her husband? The last time you see the Messiah on the mount is when he ascended up into heaven with two men on both sides in white apparel. And then 10 days later, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. So we have an illumination here with Moses. We have illumination with the outpouring of the Holy Spirit with Yahshua the Son after being on the third mountain, his third trip on the mountain. So showing how he's fulfilling jot and tittle, the law and the prophets. Can't make this stuff up. Yep. I hope and trust you got something that was said on the floor today. Sure. Thank you. Hallelujah. Thank you. All
right. Oh, God. Turn my head. That shit hurts.
Thank you, Dr. Williams. That will conclude today's lecture. Do we have any announcements? Just Samuel, if anybody, he's home, he's resting, he's getting stronger. So, we're just keeping him in our thoughts. We hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring all your friends and all your enemies, because this is truly the place to learn something truthful of your Heavenly Father, Yahweh. Let us all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah.